We have a bunch of media ground to cover, both with regards to CNN and also the New York Times, with Daniel Bogoslaw, who joins us now. He's a reporter for The Intercept, who's been breaking some incredibly important stories there. Great to see you, Daniel.
Good to see you, Dan.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, of course. So let's start with this story that you just put out about CNN. You got an internal leak, put this up on the screen, that reveals that Christian Amanpour actually expressed in an internal meeting, along with a number of other staffers, great concern over CNN's coverage of the Israel assault on the Gaza Strip. She mentioned, you know, that you've got sort of hypocrisy. I don't think that was the word that she used. But go ahead and break down for us what you heard in this leaked meeting.
Sure. Well, I think the largest takeaway from this was the continued confirmation of an earlier report I did about the concerns raised by the CNN internal protocol for all Israel coverage. It's called the Second Eyes alias. It's basically an internal system that ensures all news concerning Israel or Palestine is run through a team of editors, largely comprised of Jerusalem Bureau staff members. And the rationale given by CNN is to ensure that subject matter experts and people on the ground have an opportunity to touch and oversee the reporting of an extremely sensitive issue. However, multiple staffers last month expressed to me that this protocol caused serious delays in getting out Israel coverage, and also ultimately shaped the editorial line regarding Israel and Palestine by prioritizing IDF statements at the top of pieces. And basically just the system, while justified by CNN executives and editors for, you know, ensuring accuracy, really resulted in a degradation of the Israel coverage. And that was confirmed this week when we published a story about an internal meeting at CNN, where even Christian Amanpour, you know, the chief international correspondent, similarly expressed concern about a double standard that was created through this protocol. And her concern was echoed by a number of other staffers who were present at this meeting, who said that they felt delegitimized by CNN's coverage. They felt that it was delegitimizing CNN's standing in the region. And according to one staffer, turning on CNN was more concerning than the bombs falling around them while they were covering Israel's attack in Lebanon.
Yeah. So, Daniel, you've also been at the forefront of exposing some of what's going on over at the New York Times. And there has now been a witch hunt that has been started inside the Times, not necessarily to question some of the reporting around their October 7 rape story, but instead to find out who are the people who have been leaking to you. So what do you make of a media organization starting a leak investigation, even though they themselves subsist on leaks, whenever it's something that makes them look bad, given your reporting?
Well, I think it confirms a lot of what we heard throughout the course of reporting about the internal structural flaws present at the New York Times. Mm-hmm. Instead of trying to listen to the reporters who they trust to put out accurate news from dangerous and challenging places, who are speaking up and saying this story did not meet the standards which we all try to hold ourselves to as reporters and editors, the Times is completely ignoring the people on the ground. They're ignoring the people who make that newspaper function and provide it with the reporting that it you know, it is the foundation of the whole thing. And they're saying no, we are going to crack down. And as a source pointed out, you know, people do not leak because they're hyper radicalized partisans. You know, that is the picture that I think the Times is trying to paint, that you know, these are people who are stepping out of line, who are prioritizing their own personal politics over the good of the institution. But as one source pointed out, that it's actually the opposite is true. For almost all leakers, be they government officials or New York Times staffers, leaking is a course of last resort when the official channels for attempting to reform catastrophic system failures break down. And I think that's certainly what all of us who have been reporting on this have noticed and observed talking to people on the inside.
I just want to remind people, too, what the story is that you reported out. And as we referenced, this has to do with what they billed as this blockbuster intensive investigation into sexual assault being used systematically as a weapon of war by Hamas on October 7th. And there were three reporters who were bylined on that piece. Immediately after it was published, it came under a lot of scrutiny. Actually, one of the main victims in the story, her family, she was murdered on October 7th by Hamas. Her family freaked out. They rebutted the reports. They said, "You interviewed us under false pretenses. We had no idea that this was about a rape. We actually do not believe that she was raped. We have no evidence that she was raped. And actually, we have evidence in the other direction that she was not raped." Some of the quote-unquote eyewitnesses that they cited had changed their stories. There were all sorts of issues here. And you all received this leak that The Daily, their, you know, premier podcast, had planned an episode around this blockbuster investigation that they eventually ended up shelving because they either had to soften the language and raise questions and make it less ambiguous than the report, which was very conclusive in asserting what happened, or go with the original reporting, which had, you know, sort of fallen apart under scrutiny, or shelve it all together. And that's what they ultimately decided to do. You all have since reported additional information about Anat Schwartz, who was revealed online by C-Squirrel to have effectively no background in journalism, but to have served previously in the IDF in an intelligence unit. Another of the reporters bylined on the piece, Adam Sella, also had very limited experience. And these were the two reporters charged with, you know, the extensive, quote unquote, on the ground investigation. So there's been a lot of tumult around this piece, around how these reporters with no experience got to work at the premier elite media institution in probably the world. And so the response to that from the New York Times isn't, gosh, what happened here? How do we get this report wrong? What are the issues? How did these journalists, quote unquote journalists with really no experience, how did they get put on this piece? No, the response has been to go after the people to shine the light on the problem that is actually unfolding at the Times. And there's another shoe to drop here. This was also a number of outlets got their hands on this letter that came from the Times Union. Put this up on the screen from the Washington Post. The union is saying not only are you doing this leak hunt, but you are racially targeting, you are racially profiling your employees, assuming that anyone with, you know, who's presumably like Arab American or Muslim or who has some sort of identity that you think may be skeptical of Israel's line, you are singling them out and targeting them here. Talk about this piece of it, because, I mean, they say directly, we demand the Times cease what has become a destructive and racially targeted witch hunt in response to the reports that you all have put out.
Sure. So, you know, I think what the union is referring to here is the sort of interrogation of members of a Middle East affinity group within the New York Times, and you know, the Times pushed back on the union statement and said, you know, that this is inaccurate. And if you actually look at the spread of the people that we've interrogated, you'll see that we're not racially profiling our staffers.
We're interrogating everyone. Don't worry.
Yeah, but again, it's shocking that, you know, each step of this process, you know, you have an opportunity for newsroom leadership to take responsibility. To reassure the reporters who work extremely hard and put their lives at risk at times to cover this reporting. And there's an opportunity to actually welcome real feedback from the people who are on the ground doing this, who want to see the paper succeed, who work there. For many of them, that's the end of the line. That's the you know, top goal for so many reporters to get in there. Yeah. And you know, that notion that they are that they're reporters who have invested so much in this company would be willing to throw it all away for frivolous personal reasons instead of for wanting to see the organization succeed is proof of concept for perhaps why some of these flaws and failures have been allowed to fester and exist for so long.
Daniel, Ryan had predicted online that this leak investigation was likely to backfire and trigger additional leaks because of people being upset by this response. You know, has that prediction come to fruition? Are you having more staffers come to you? Are you hearing more from your sources?
Yeah, I mean, I can't speak to Ryan's Rolodex, but I know certainly that has been the case for myself. Yes.
All right. Well, good. We look forward to seeing more of it. Appreciate your work, Dan.
Thanks, Daniel. Great to see you.
Thanks for having me.
Hey, guys, if you like that video, go to breakingpoints.com, become a premium subscriber, and help us build the best independent media organization on the planet.
That's right. We're subscriber funded. We're building something new. We want to replace these failing mainstream media organizations.
So again, to subscribe, it's breakingpoints.com.